from the high desert of Southern California and on the web at praiseyahuwah.com, announcing the kingdom of Yahuwah. And now it's time for truth with your servant host, Denya Cajaliero.
A beautiful, wonderful, and joyful morning and day to you from Dia and I. Denya, we love you with all our hearts. We hope that Yahuwah, and we know that Yahuwah has blessed you. How has Yahuwah blessed you these last couple weeks? Well, all the things that he does for us, just the existence in him alone is enough for you and I, is it not? So grateful to be like Kepha and John, Yahuwkanan, and the other disciples who Master truly loved and held him to them to his chest, and the love, like the love of a father, or maybe more closely resembling perhaps a younger brother or sister that we deeply love and who deeply loves us. He is truly our refuge, our master to Yahuwah, and our almighty loving father who uses him, a tool of love that he is. And so in love, we keep his covenant words, because that was his command for all eternity. And that was also the statement of his son in Matthew 19, that we would keep the covenant words, that we would know them. And so he takes us out of misery and bondage, because he is our almighty one. And he tells us not to have foreign Elohim before our face. That is the plural of many gods. And we only have Yahuwah, our one almighty loving Father. We have him and his son, who is at his right hand, promoted. He says, don't make contaminations of things that are images and that are things that the world worships. Don't bow before them, before anything, he says, that's in the heavens. So if someone makes an idol of him or an idol of his son, don't bow to those things. We are to spiritually connect to him, or anything that is in the earth beneath or in the water under the earth. Specific statements for things that the world does not understand, but we as Yahuwah's people know that there are things that people do worship on this earth, beneath this earth, and under the water. These Zeus gods, and also in representation of things that are in other dimension, because water is that dividing line of this reality as it encases the entire firmament above and below and all around. And passing through, the act of passing or going into another dimension where there are these other creatures is a thing that we would not be tempted or have anything to do with. Those beings who have wanted to be like the Almighty, that have wanted to put themselves over you in place of serving you as Yahuwah's people, because their pride would not allow them. He says, for these ones, don't bow yourself down to them or serve these Elohim, these false God creatures, because he is the only one that we are to love and to worship. He says that if we do those things, if we keep to these false gods and these false ones, and part of that is being faithless by even using their names, by not realizing he has one name. But he says, don't even have anything to do with them. Don't worship them in any way. Don't give them credibility in any way. Because if you do, then you continue in the sins that are passed down. But there are 1,000 invitations given to many generations over and over. Don't ignore him. Don't ignore his great name, but love him. Keep his covenant word. It's interesting that his covenant has this keeping of his covenant directly in its body, right next to not treating his name as unimportant, because it is the entryway to him. It is that connection. And it has to do with these other Elohim not being even said, giving them credibility in our worship. I notice many will say the great name of Yahuwah, and then they'll say other names. Or they'll say the name of what they believe is our master as Yahushua, who is now the risen Yahuwah. And they will still utilize the Zeus names as though it's okay to declare a Zeus name as our Savior's name when it is not. It is detestable. And so, do you really feel that way in your heart, and do you show it by your speaking? Some say, well, this is just so others will know who we're talking about. They know who you're talking about. When you say Yahuwah Savior, they know who you're talking about. When you say Yahuwah the Father, they know who you're talking about. Are you keeping this Shabbat day? Laboring 6 and resting 7th. Very simple. Honoring your father and your mother by your walk in Yahuwah. There's something that you do that honors them. You can do a lot of things. You can be a CEO of the greatest company in the world, but it doesn't mean it honors your father and your mother. It's your walk in Yahuwah that honors your father and your mother. Do not murder. Do not be adulterous in your conduct, in all things. Do not steal. Do not talk falsely about the word of Yahuwah and the truth and the good news of things to all those who would listen. Because truly, who is your neighbor? It's anyone, right? Your neighbor is everyone and anyone that you are around in your circle. And then don't lust after things, every type of thing. The only thing that we desire is our Father and to be with Master. That should be our heart's fullest desire. And so everything else is passing away. Do this all with your heart, loving Yahuwah, with your mind and your very being, and then loving your neighbors, being a loving person. Then you know that you're doing the covenant in the love and in the way of Master. And that's really why he came, to show us the loving aspect of this covenant. Well, brothers and sisters, today we have a wonderful declaration that Yahuwah has provided this last few days ago. And it's because I believe the time that we're living in, we're living truly in the season of the end of the ways of sinful man. And today we're going to be talking about, and the declaration is entitled, No Stone Unturned, the 24 elders and the 2 raptures, or harpazo, in Joshua, of all places, or Yahushua, which means Yahuwah is our Savior. And that's important to know. We're going to be reading from the book of Joshua. Some of the things we'll be talking about is, and understanding, is proof that the 24 elders are in fact the 144,000. And this is an Old Testament revelation, which is something that many have stated. There is no proof in the Old Testament. We do now have proof outside of Revelation and the New Testament. Is there evidence in Scripture to support a pre-tribulation and mid-tribulation gathering? Well, we know that there is. We've been seeing it in other prophets like Hosea and others. But today we'll find it, and we'll see it in the book of Joshua. Hallelujah. And we'll be discussing that, along with the importance of the meaning of stones and rocks in Scripture, because it's key to understanding all of this. Hence the title, No Stone Unturned. And it's very appropriate here in Scripture. There are going to be many numbers and signs in Scripture. And we're going to be talking about many of those today. Numbers can be very easy to pass over in Scripture, and yet numbers, numerical quotations, are announcements of things. And if everything was as plain as your face, then the world would easily know and understand these things. But Yahuwah settles these things and opens our hearts and minds as he said he would in the latter days, especially. And I believe that what Yahuwah has provided for us to declare today is truly revelation and truly an amazing understanding that is going to lift your heart and bring you such gladness, because your future is truly provided. He truly is your father. He truly gives you his son or daughter good things, and truly cares for you and knows you and will take care of you. He truly is our reliance, that which we can rely upon. Now, Joshua, speaking of Joshua and the book of Joshua, meaning Yahuwah's salvation, interestingly enough, speaking on numbers, it is the sixth book in Scripture. And it's interesting because the number six also is the number of man. We're just one short of perfection, which is seven, the fullest, the best of. Now, it is the first of 12 books known as the books of history. That is Joshua through Esther. And that number 12 is interesting as well, because these 12 books of history are really examples and mirroring so much of what we read in the New Testament and prophecy of things which truly announce the kingdom of Yahuwah, his great name, his covenant. And after these, there are 60 books to follow it. And we say 60 because of the fact that there are some books that were truly taken out of Scripture that should be in there. 60 being a variation of six. But it's interesting that it has 24 chapters in the book. And why that's interesting is because the number 24 is significant, especially in our declaration today. The 24 elders we've been discussing in recent broadcasts, and the 24 elders are key to our understanding the pre-tribulation harpazo, and especially is significant to you, because you, being one who has and is washing their robe and making them white, making it bright white in the blood of the Lamb, in Yahuwah, in the walk, in the way, this is significant because you are one of the 24 elders, and this declaration today will absolutely show that. It'll prove it to you as a true witness. Whereas it has been hard for many to rest only on Revelation as one witness of 24 elders, this will give you that second witness that is required. And so the number 24 is a revealing in the book of Joshua that isn't as simple as doing a word search, let's say, and finding it. Finding it is one of those things that Yahuwah allows his people to do. And it's a matter of statement. It's a matter of realization, so that others can see when there are revelation, declaration of revelation, that when you see that, then it causes you to take notice of not just that one statement by one person, but perhaps many other things that are being revealed. It causes one to say, well, that's very interesting. It seems that there is some sort of anointed revealing going on here that would cause one to listen to many things. Certainly, since 2010, at praiseyahuwah.com, and it's time for truth. We've been declaring many things that we feel that Yahuwah has put on our hearts. And so today is very important and probably the most important broadcast that we've ever done because of what it means to you and I. And it's no coincidence that this comes about right now and reveals itself to us. There's no coincidence in Yahuwah. Everything he plans out, everything in your life has occurred for a reason, the good and the bad. Now, there's 658 verses in the book of Joshua as well. Now, if you take 6 times 5 times 8, you get 240. Again, this is another variation of 24, just like having 24 chapters. The scriptures are full of calculations, and you can truly go too far focusing strictly and only on numbers. But numbers are very important, just as we've stated. And so we, in faith, we announce this because faithfully we can see the design in scripture. So as observation on Joshua, Joshua was born a slave in Egypt or Mitzrayim, but he became a conqueror in Canaan. He became Israel's leader at the age of 85, and he led Israel for over 24 years. He died at the age of 110, and at 50 years of age, he was one of the 12 spies in Scripture that Moses had sent out from Kadesh Barnea. Now, 12, again, being a variation of many important things, and especially in our declaration today. But it's interesting that he was one of the 12 spies, because today we're going to talk about the two spies also that are declared in Joshua and how those relate to the two witnesses in Revelation. And so Joshua exhibits three great qualities we notice as we read from Scripture. He shows over and over his obedience and faith in Yahuwah. He also shows great courage. He shows an extreme dedication to Yahuwah and his covenant word, which is very important. The entire book of Joshua has to do with passing over, passing through, entering, and then subsequent conquerings. Especially in the Jericho and then in the land of Canaan. First 6 chapters dealing mainly with Jericho, and then the 7th chapter to the very end of the 24th chapter, the military campaigns wherein he with Yasarel engaged more than 30 armies. Now, he did this over a 7-year period. Now, that's important as well, the number 7. Now, Joshua begins where Deuteronomy leaves off, and he takes Yasarel from the wilderness to the promised land. In the book of Joshua, the fulfillment of the land promised that was made to Abraham by our father, Genesis 12:6, becomes fulfilled. That prophecy, that statement, that declaration. This is that then Yahuwah appeared to Abram and said, to your descendants, I will give this land. Well, we're going to see in today's discussion, the first 6 chapters of Joshua, we're going to see that promise fulfilled. But also, you're going to see that promise fulfilled in you. More importantly, because how does this affect you? This greatly affects you. So we're going to be excitingly talking about this because it's an amazing, wonderful thing that Yahuwah has provided. Now let's turn to Joshua chapter 1, verse 1, also known as Yahushua or Yahoshua in many Bibles. It says, and it came to be after the death of Moshe, the servant of Yahuwah, that Yahuwah spoke to Yahushua, son of Nun, the assistant of Moshe, saying, Moshe, my servant, is dead. So now arise, pass over this Yarden, you and all this people, to the land which I am giving to them, to the children of Yasarel. So as you know, Moshe was not able to go to the land flowing with milk and honey. He had erred. He had sinned. He had made a statement when declaring the water from the rock without giving Yahuwah all the credit, everything. Now he repented of that, but at the time, it was something that was so unforgivable that he really messed it up for himself greatly. And so he was not able to pass through of the Yarden. And so Joshua was given this statement by Yahuwah, and he realized that he was going to be passing over this Yarden. Now, what's interesting is in verse 2, it talks about passing over. Passover in Scripture is a very faithful statement because of what happened in Mitzrayim, Egypt. Passing over is also passing through, a reference to Passover, especially when it comes out when it's the taking out of the wilderness and then going into this promised land flowing with milk and honey. It says in Ezekiel 45:21, in the first month, on the 14th day of the month, you have Passover, a festival of 7 days, unleavened bread is eaten. Well, we know that with Joshua, it was over a 7-year period that this conquering occurred in this land flowing with milk and honey. And the first month of the 14th day of the month, Passover being such an important event, especially now as it relates to Master. Further in Joshua 1, verse 3, it says, every place on which the sole of your foot treads, I have given to you, as I spoke to Moshe. From the wilderness and this Lebanon, even as far as the great river, the river Euphrates, all the land of the Hittites, and to the sea, toward the going down of the sun, is your border. So it's this vast area, beautiful, lush, gorgeous area. Not what you would think with regards to the place known as Israel today. No, completely and vastly different at that time. A land promised to Yahuwah's people, beautiful with energy and life and beauty and every type of desire you can imagine in a land, the beauty. Because this is what was promised to his people. It says, no man is going to stand before you all the days of your life. As I was with Moshe, so I am with you. I do not fail you, nor do I forsake you. So Joshua knows going in, he knows going in that he will conquer. He will overcome. Though there be all sorts of different peoples and evil and those anti of Yahuwah in these lands, very pagan area, he knows nothing will stop him. And he has his faith. And Yahuwah even says, be strong and courageous, for you are to let this people inherit the land which I swore to their fathers to give to them. Only be strong and very courageous to guard to do according to all the Torah, which Moshe, my servant, commanded you. Do not turn from it right or left so that you act wisely wherever you go. See, covenant keeping, brothers and sisters, not to be confused with the Torah of Moshe. This is the Torah of Yahuwah as given to Moshe. These covenant words. Every time in Scripture that man is turned from the Torah, the covenant word, it has gone badly. Stay in the covenant word, be strong and courageous. This is also a statement to you and I. We do not hold back, do we? He says, do not let this book of the Torah depart from your mouth, but you shall Meditate on it day and night so that you guard to do according to all that is written in it. For then you shall make your way prosperous and act wisely. Of course, we know that he did this because we've read these books and we know how successful he was. There's a clear requirement of covenant keeping, just like Revelation 3:8 says, I know your works. See, I've set before you an open door. What is that door? That is that door in covenant, that first doorway, great name that we are to keep set apart. And he's opened that door for us to go through. And he knows if you're doing it or not. He says, and no one is able to shut it that you have little power. See, right now, brothers and sisters, there is little power for you and I. We're mainly focusing on learning and getting our own situation right with Yahuwah, right? And fighting and overcoming. He says in Revelation over and over, to those that overcome, to those that overcome, that he will do this and he will do that. What does it mean to overcome? It means that you have things that you're doing in your life and you will overcome them. You will overcome them. That you will ask for his helper and he will give you the helper and you will overcome. And you are to overcome. He says, you have a little power. He says, but yet you have guarded my word, just like it says in covenant, and have not denied my name. See those two things that go together, the covenant word and his name? Folks, those are the two things that we are to truly focus on. And it so simply does not make it complicated for us. Man makes it complicated with lots of do's and don'ts. But this tells you the simplicity of guarding my word and not denying my name. So he provides to you and to me a very simple formula and hope of salvation. He says, because you have guarded my word of endurance, I also shall guard you from the hour of trial which shall come upon the world. I try those who dwell on the earth. Now, here's the thing. This is a statement that if you keep his name set apart and you guard his word, then he's going to guard you from the great tribulation. Oh, you'll have trials and tribulations, but this is the hour of trial. Master talks about it's not yet his time, or that hour hasn't come. This is the hour of trial that he's going to guard you from. He's going to take you out of this. Back to Joshua 1:9 now. It says, have I not commanded you? See, there are commands. Be strong and courageous. Do not be afraid nor be discouraged, for Yahuwah, your Eloah Ya'am, is with you wherever you go. And he says that in Revelation, doesn't he? Also in Revelation, further it says in 3 verse 11, see, I am coming speedily. Hold what you have that no one take your crown. He who overcomes, I shall make him a supporting post in the dwelling place of my Eloah Ya'am. See, this is Master talking. You have guarded his word and his name, you see, faithfully understood what his name is and held to it. It says, and he shall by no means go out. I shall write on him the name of my Eloah Ya'am and the name of the city of my Eloah Ya'am, the renewed Yerushalem, which comes down out of the heaven from my Eloah Ya'am, and my renewed name. This is all an important understanding, because when we praise Yahuwah, we not only praise the Father, we not only praise his Ruach, which is his breath, his active force, which is Yahuwah, but we praise his Son who has a renewed name, Yahuwah, because Master said, your name which you have given me, your name which you have given me, Joshua 1:10, it says, and Yahushua commanded the officers of the people, saying, pass through. Here we go with the passing again. The midst of the camp, command the people, saying, prepare for yourselves food, for within 3 days you are passing over this Jordan to go into the and possess the land which Yahuwah, your Elohim, is giving to you to possess. Now, Hosea 6:2, which we read recently, it said what? After 2 days, he shall revive us. On the third day, he shall raise us up so that we live before him. So what does he tell them? He says, get ready, because within 3 days, you're passing over, Passover, into the Yarden and through it. That body of water, brothers and sisters, is significant in the passing through, as we talked about at the very beginning. Because this passing over and through this water is a representation of you passing, being taken, harpazoed, passing through, passing over. It says, and it's very interesting, because when you look at 3 days, we know that with Master, and up until the time of Master, is 4,000 years, or 4 days. Because a day to Yahuwah is 1,000 years. Remember, one and 1,000 can be the same thing. And we're to read scripture with that kind of thought process in our minds. Now, from Master, his actual death to now is 2,000 years, or 2 days. So this says within 3 days. And Hosea says, and after 2 days, and on the third day, and in the morning. Remember that? Keep that in mind as we read here. Joshua 1 verse 12. And Joshua, spoke to the Reubenites and to the Gadites, and to half the tribe of Manasseh, saying, remember the word which Moshe, servant of Yahuwah, commanded you, saying, Yahuwah, your Elohim, is giving you rest, and he shall give you this land. So it's a Passover rest, and it does take 7 years in the entire book. At the end of that 7 year period, in 7 days, and 7,000 days, and 7 years as well, those are all and do in scripture represent similar things depending on where and what. And the seventh day of rest, as you know, is after the end of 6 days. It's also the end of 6,000 years in the beginning of that new great millennium reign. Now, Joshua 1 verse 14, let your wives, your little ones, your livestock stay in the land which Moshe gave to you beyond the Arden. But you shall pass before your brothers in fives, all your brave fighters, and shall help them. We're going to talk about the meaning of the fives later. But right now, until Yahuwah has given your brothers rest as unto you, so shall they also take possession of the land which Yahuwah your Elohim is giving them. Then you shall return to the land of your possession and shall possess that which Moshe, the servant of Yahuwah, gave you beyond the Yarden toward the rising of the sun. And they answered Yahushua, saying, all that you have commanded us, we do, and wherever you send us, we go. You see, what a great leader Yahushua was. What a great man. And they trusted in Yahuwah, and they knew that this was a righteous man, Yahushua, that Yahuwah had provided to lead them. Verse 17 of chapter 1 says, according to all that we obeyed Moshe, so we obey you. Only let Yahuwah your Elohim be with you as he was with Moshe. Whoever rebels against your command and does not obey your words, and all that you command him is put to death. Only be strong and courageous. See, he declares what Yahuwah told him faithfully. And verse 18 is interesting because it shows the seriousness of keeping the commandments. It's sobering when we realize that when we do not repent in the covenant word and all things and overcome, that the result for those who say they are his but are not, because they don't overcome, will result in death, as we know from scripture, as opposed to those who fully repent and are able to cross over into this and through this figurative Yarden, body of water that's to come, this spiritual Yarden, which will occur. The Yarden, brothers and sisters, is synonymous with harpazo and rapture for purposes of this book. And so every time you hear the Yarden, you will hear in your mind rapture and harpazo. And fully repenting is what is crucial. Keeping the commands is crucial, because anyone who does not right now overcome, begin to overcome in every way, when the hour of tribulation comes upon mankind, if you are here, more than likely you will pass away, whether faithfully or not faithfully. And there will be some who won't. But that hour is going to be so great and so horrible. You do not want to be part of that. And that's why it says in verse 18 that there's this death upon the one who doesn't keep the commands. Because it's also a warning to us today. If you don't overcome and do, then you're going to be facing death. It doesn't mean that you still won't be given a resurrection. It just means you're going to pass away more than likely. And matter of factly. And so this is why this message is crucial today, right now. Joshua chapter 2, now verse 1, it says, Yahushua, son of Nun, secretly sent out two men from Shittim to spy, saying, go see the land and Jericho. And they went, and they came to the house of a woman, a whore, and her name was Rahab, and they lay down there. Now what's interesting is in Revelation, there is this correlation between the whore in Scripture and also the two witnesses, where he says in Revelation 11:3, and I shall give unto my two witnesses. And so Yahushua sends out two men, two witnesses, who are also two spies. And it's symbolic. It was symbolic when Joshua was one of the 12 spies, for many reasons, and it's symbolic here that he sends out two spies at this time. Whether he realized any of this was going to have such incredible meaning to us later on or not. Joshua 2:2 says, but it was reported to the sovereign of Jericho, saying, see, men from the children of Yisrael have come here tonight to search out the land. Well, we know from Scripture that these two witnesses are going to be known, that the beast will know who they are, and even the people will know who they are. Verse 3, and the sovereign of Jericho sent to Rahab, saying, bring out the men who have come to you, who have entered your house, for they have come to search out all the land. But the woman had taken the two men and hid them. So she said, the men came to me, but I did not know where they were from. Then it came to be, as the gate was being shut, when it was dark, that the men went out. I do not know where the men went. Pursue them quickly so that you overtake them. But she had brought them up to the roof and hidden them with the stalks of flax, which she had laid out on the roof. Now, it's interesting because she's lying to these ones, right? She's telling a fib. But brothers and sisters, when you look at the covenant word, and they say something like, thou shalt not lie. It's thou shalt not give a false testimony to a near one. There's a greater meaning in this. It also means that we don't go around being dishonest people, right? But I tell you right now, brothers and sisters, this woman is to be rewarded with her life because she lied. Now, this may be hard to understand because Christendom has taught people to just flatly fall on a sword in many ways. They've taught people incorrectly the covenant word. Thou shalt not lie, instead of thou shalt not give false testimony. Thou shalt not kill, instead of thou shalt not murder. And the people not knowing the difference. Honor your father and mother, instead of honoring your father and mother by your walk in Yahuwah. Two different things. And so many other things in the covenant word, which people have no understanding of because they're ignorant to the truth. Now, this woman lied. Why? Not because she was to be deceptive in her life and in her walk, but she did this to protect these two spies who she knew were crucial. There was a faith in her right now was not in all this land of Jericho. And not only are we going to read that it would save her, but it saves her family. So she takes them to a roof and she hides them among stalks of flax. And scholars believe, it's interesting, I was doing some research because I was thinking in terms of the two witnesses, and I'm thinking in terms of the rapture, and I'm always thinking in terms of these things now from the prophets, because I'm realizing that there are like three things consistently over and over with the prophets: keeping covenant, keeping Yahuwah's name set apart and great, Father and Son, and also the rapture. So I'm thinking in terms of this. So scholars believe, speaking of the two witnesses, that sackcloth was originally woven by people in Mesopotamia very early in recorded history. Abraham hailed from this area of the world, so he was more than likely familiar with this material in his lifetime. Now, sackcloth fabric is a very coarse cloth. We know that the two witnesses, it says they will be wearing sackcloth. It was woven from several kinds of fibers and especially flax. Sackcloth is generally considered to be rough, itchy, abrasive, and loosely woven potato sack type material that most of us today are sort of familiar with. Although now everything comes in plastic bags when we buy potatoes, but our parents and our parents' parents, when they would buy potatoes, they would be in these sackcloths. So it says in Revelation 11:3, "And I shall give unto my two witnesses, they shall prophesy 1,260 days clad in sackcloth." And so she hides them with the stalks of flax, or you could say covers them in sackcloth. Yet another facet to understanding what Revelation means when it says they're clothed in sackcloth. Literally, clothed in potato sacks? Maybe. But a spiritual element being stated here when it comes to being hidden in the stalks of flax. Further, it says in chapter 2, verse 7, "The men pursued them by the way to the Arden, to the fords, and they shut the gate afterwards as soon as the pursuers had gone. And before they lay down, she came up to them on the roof, and she said to the men, I know that Yahuwah has given you the land, and that the fear of you has fallen on us, and that all the inhabitants of the land melt away because of you." Now Revelation 11:11 says that, "And after the 3.5 days, a spirit of life from Eloah Ya'am entered into them, and they stood upon their feet, and great fear fell on those who saw them." It's interesting, this woman says to the two spies, these two witnesses, that the people, it says, fear has fallen on us. So now we see chapter 2, verse 9, and Revelation 11:11. Interesting, today is 11:11. I just realized. Praise Yahuwah. Joshua 2, verse 10, "For we have heard how Yahuwah dried up the waters of the sea reeds for you when you came out of Mitzrayim, and what you did to the two sovereigns of the Amorites who were beyond the Jordan, Sihon and Og, whom you put under the ban. And when we heard, our hearts melted, and there was no spirit left in anyone because of you. For Yahuwah, your Eloah Ya'am, he is Eloah Ya'am of the heavens above and on the earth and beneath. And now please swear to me by Yahuwah, since I have shown you kindness, that you also show kindness to my father's house and shall give me a true token." See, brothers and sisters, when it declares in verse 11, Yahuwah of the heavens above the earth and on the earth and beneath, what is she talking about? She's verbatim declaring covenant. And so this is significant because it is her faithfulness now that is being shown, her faith in Yahuwah, her trust. And she's very wise and very careful and very crafty, where she was known as a whore, but now there's actions here of repentance. And she says, in verse 13, "shall spare my father and my mother and my brothers and my sister and all they have, and shall deliver our lives from death." And the men said to her, our lives for yours. If you do not expose this matter of ours, then it shall be, when Yahuwah has given us the land, that we shall treat you in the kindness and truth. Now, a promise is being made to her and to her family because of her faithfulness, if she shall do just so. It says, so she let them down by a rope. I want you to take note of the word rope. Through the window, for her house was on the city wall, and she dwelt on the wall. So this woman who we read at the very beginning of Joshua as this harlot transforms her actions by faith and faithfulness, actions of faith, not just words. It's a very important distinction. Now she's known as she. Have you noticed this over and over? She doesn't say the harlot, the whore, says she, because she's transforming herself. Says this is symbolic of her mid-tribulation repentance. See, what's happening right now is there's an hour of tribulation that's about to come upon this city of Jericho. And she's repenting. But she's in this hour now. She's in it. And we'll see later that she's still in it when horns are blown. And she's repenting from her selfish and immoral ways, becoming set apart, being faithful, being heroic. See, this is what Yahuwah told Joshua to tell his people, to be heroic. And so she's being heroic because she could have been very selfish and said, you know, I'm this is too much for me. I can't do this. No, you brothers and sisters, Yahuwah's people are to be heroic. And certainly those who are caught in the tribulation, who are not taken out, are going to need to be very heroic to the very end. But we want you to be heroic now. We want you to overcome now. We want you to be out of here, as Yahuwah promises you, if you do his will right now. Many are called, but few are chosen, because few will overcome. So there's this harpazo or gathering about to occur for her that she's been promised and her family's been promised out of this tribulation of Jericho. Further evidence that she's a changed woman and that she's accepting Yahuwah and being saved, because she's now represented in Revelation 12, described as being clothed with the sun, with the moon under her feet, and her head a crown of 12 stars representing the Old Testament Yasharal. Yahuwah referred to his people as a woman whom he had dressed in honor and splendor in Ezekiel 16. The garland with 12 stars in Revelation is symbolic of the 12 tribes of Yasharal from Genesis 37, 9 to 10. So she is this woman, a repentant woman, a woman who had hoard, but there's still hope for her. Just as there was hope for the 12 tribes when they were so unfaithful, but finally, they were. Now, we said, take note of the rope that she lowered the two witnesses down on. Chebel in Strong's H2256, that word Chebel or Kebel. It's representing there in definition pain, pangs of sorrow. Keep that in mind as we read further. Also Mark 14:34. And he said to them, my being is exceedingly grieved, even to death. Stay here and watch. And some began to spit on him and to blindfold him, to beat him, to say to him, prophesy. And others struck him with the palms of their hands. See, he endured pain. He endured sorrows specifically. Revelation 12, 1 and 2, a great sign was seen in heaven, a woman clad with the sun, the moon under her feet, a head of a crown, 12 stars, and being pregnant, she cried out in labor and in pain to give birth. So this rope represents spiritually to us today pain and sorrow. And it's mentioned first in Joshua. Then, further, in this next verse, Joshua 2:16, it says, and she said to them, go to the mountain, lest the pursuers come upon you, and you shall hide there 3 days until the pursuers have returned, and afterwards go on your way. Now, hide there 3 days. Another symbol. What does that mean? Matthew 12:39, 40, 41. But he answering said to them, a wicked and adulterous generation seeks after a sign, and no sign shall be given to it except the sign of the prophet Jonah. For as Jonah was 3 days and three nights in the stomach of the great fish, so shall the Son of Adam be 3 days and three nights in the heart of the earth. Men of Nineveh shall stand up in the judgment with this generation and condemn it, because they repented at the preaching of Jonah, and look, greater than Jonah is here. So these ones for 3 days hide out. Brothers and sisters, last year, the sign of Jonah was given to the world. It specifically went across the United States. 7 years later, in the year 2024, there will be another sign, just like that one, which is an eclipse, crossing the eclipse that happened last summer. We're to take note of these signs. It's a 7-year period, but it is the sign of Jonah. And so this is apropos, especially when you read Revelation 11:12, and they heard a loud voice from heaven saying, come up here. And they went up into the heaven in a cloud, and their enemies saw them. So this 7-year period is a period of repentance. Because why? Because there is a gathering to happen. There is a gathering that's going to occur for those who do repent. And Nineveh repented. They understood this sign of Jonah. This sign of Jonah that's across the entire United States, not just for the United States, it is, but for the world to repent right now. To keep covenant, keep his name, Father and Son. Declare it and realize there is a hope. And the 3 days represent a safety net and a sign. And we look at 3 days and we know what 3 days is. Again, the first 2,000 years and then the beginning, the morning of the third 1,000 years. 2,000 years from Master till now, which, by the way, occurs in 2031, and we'll talk about that. We know the season. We're aware of it. Just as Yahuwah made Joshua aware that there were going to be these things happening and what he needed to do, and he made his people aware, Yahuwah makes you aware. Joshua 2:17, the men said to her, we are released from this oath of yours, which you have made us swear, unless when we come to this land, you bind this line, that word line, you bind this line of scarlet cord in the window through which you let us down. And unless you bring your father and your mother and your brothers and all your father's household to your own home. So they're telling her, keep your promise and do this. Put this scarlet line. They didn't notice it's not referred to as rope. So we had rope, we had hide 3 days, and we had line. What we're witnessing is someone not previously set apart by her actions, remember, harlot, whore, showing now her faithfulness in the midst of an evil, oppressing people of Jericho. Showing great courage, doing the right thing, aiding the two spies. And we see yet again, what? Her family members are going to be blessed, just like Noah, just like Lot. Because why? Because they respected her and they listened to her. They came, they also have to have an act of faithfulness by going into the home. Because it says specifically, they told her, only those that are in the home. So this was an act of faith on their part, going into the home and not turning her in to the government of Jericho. So it shows repentance on their part as well. But they were given the benefit of her, just like Noah and Lot, who were taken out. So now they're telling her this line of scarlet cord to be put out. And it's not referred to as a rope, even though it's called a cord. So it's two different statements being made here. And if you don't look at these subtleties in Strong's, you won't see the difference. Line in Strong's, or Tikva, Strong's H8615, it says expectancy, expectation figuratively, a cord of expectation, hope, to live, to be longed for. And it's also from H690, which means to bind together or to collect or to gather. And so the cord, this AKA red scarlet line, is significant because, like other Passovers, brothers and sisters, blood was posted over the doorway for the saving of all those inside. And so there's the similarity of the original Passover in Egypt to her now, and there's a similarity to her for those going through the tribulation of this Jericho that will come upon the world, which is a great tribulation. So the Yarden represents Passover through, and the Jericho represents the great tribulation, the hour of tribulation. Exodus 12:5 says, let the lamb be a perfect one, a year old male. Take it from the sheep or from the goats, and you shall keep it until the 14th day of the same month. Then all the assembly of the congregation of Yasharel shall kill it between the evenings. They shall take some of the blood, put it on the two doorposts and on the lintel of the houses where they eat it. And I shall pass through the land of Mitzrayim, or Egypt, on that night. I shall smite all the firstborn of the land of Mitzrayim, both man and beast, and on the mighty ones of Mitzrayim I shall execute judgment. I am Yahuwah. And the blood shall be a sign for you on the houses where you are. When I see the blood, I shall pass over you, and let the plague not come on you to destroy you when I smite the land of Mitzrayim. Pass over. So now, looking at rope and looking at 3 days being hidden in the midst of that, and then a line in the next scripture over, those three things, verses 14 to 18, there's a full story being told here from beginning to end. Our master's suffering to the call of repentance in his blood to the mid-tribulation rapture of his repentant people, who were not repentant at first, caught in the midst of Jericho, that hour of his return, representing the great world tribulation and the bowls of wrath which are being poured out after the trumpets are sounded. And you'll notice coming up here that she only gets pulled out when the trumpets begin. So we'll note that because it's important to understanding who she is and how she represents the second gathering, the second Passover of repentance. Joshua 2:19, it shall be that anyone who goes outside the doors of your house into the street, his blood is on his own head, and we are innocent. And anyone who is with you in the house, his blood is on our head, and if a hand is laid on him. And if you expose this matter of ours, then we shall be released from your oath, which you made us swear. She said, let it be according to your words. She sent them away and they went. And she bound the scarlet cord in the window. So they left and came to the mountain and stayed there 3 days until the pursuers returned. And the pursuers sought them in all the way, but did not find them. Then the two men returned and came down from the mountain and passed over. And they came to Yahushua, son of Nun, and related to him all that had befallen them. And they said to Yahushua, truly Yahuwah has given us all the land into our hands, and also all the inhabitants of the land have melted away because of us. So again, a Revelation 11:11 talking about that great fear of the two witnesses after the 3 days. So we see the 3 days here. We see the mountain, the security, the mountain of Yahuwah. We see the land melting away, the correlation between Revelation. Joshua 3:1, Yehoshua rose early in the morning, and they set out from Shittim and came to the Yarden, he and all the children of Yisrael, and stayed there because they passed over. And it came to be after 3 days that the officers went into the midst of the camp. After 3 days being the key. And they commanded the people, See, because why it's key after 3 days? We kept hearing 3 days, 3 days, but Revelation 11:11 says 3.5 days. So after 3 days is 3.5 days, you see. So it says that they commanded the people saying, when you seek the ark, when you see the ark of the covenant of Yahuwah, your Elohim, and the priests and the Levites bearing it, then you shall set out from your place and follow it. Where else does it say that his people will see the ark of the covenant? It says in Revelation that there would be that the ark of the covenant would be there with us. So it's significant here for them as well as they pass over. So it says, only keep a distance between you and it, about 2,000 cubits by measure. Do not come near it, so that you know which way to go, for you have not passed over before this way before. So again, from the time of Master till now is 2,000 years. And we read in Hosea, the morning of the third day, that that would be that time of rapture. It's significant that he tells them to keep a distance of 2,000. It's really a prophetic warning that from the time of Master's death, 2,000 years later, to know there's not going to be any rapture. Keep your distance from this idea of Passover. You haven't passed over yet. It says, for you have not passed over this way before. So it's telling us that for 2,000 years, there would be no Passover, there would be no rapture, there would be no Passover. We're literally told. So for all these thousands of years, where people have declared a rapture date, even Jehovah's Witnesses declared it, and said millions now living will never die, and all these other different religions that have declared in the last century especially, didn't realize the 2,000 years here. By measure, and the statement being made. But it's made to us at this last hour because it truly was a statement for all of us now to look back and see when people set dates that you can't set a specific day and hour, that only Yahuwah knows that. But we were told we would know the season. This is part of knowing the season, you see, of his return 2,000 years later. And his perfect sacrifice that was made 2,000 years ago, this 2031. There's, remember, 6,000 years or 6 days from the time of man. 4 days were done at Master, but then there were 2,000 years later or two more days. So we're right at that precipice of 6,000 years, 6 days in 2031. But it's not that far away, because in 2031, you've got to remember there's got to be 7 years of the Antichrist, of Great Jericho, Great Tribulation that must occur. So that takes you to 2024. What occurs in 2024 is the end of this 7 year sign of Jonah. He says in Revelation 3:3, remember then how you have received and heard and watch and repent. If then you do not wake up, I shall come to you as a thief, and you shall not know at all what hour I come upon you. See, he tells you you're supposed to know, or to be ready at the very least, and to wake up. And this is a wake-up call in Joshua today. And the sign of Jonah occurring last year in 2017 through to 2024, just before the 7 years of the Antichrist. That's why I believe that these next years to 2024 are going to be crucial in many different ways, positive and negative, as a sign. There's going to be a lot of great things and good things. Remember, the Great Tribulation isn't going to occur till the Antichrist. But when the Antichrist comes, it's going to be devastating for those who are caught in the midst of Jericho. But there's still hope for them if they repent, just like this harlot woman. Joshua 3 verse 5 says, and Yehoshua said to the people, set yourselves apart, for tomorrow Yahuwah is doing wonders in your midst. Yehoshua spoke to the priests saying, take up the Ark of the Covenant, pass over before the people. Here we go with Passover again. So they took up the Ark of the Covenant, went before the people. Yahuwah said to Yehoshua, this day I begin to make you great before the eyes of all Yisrael, so that they know that I am with you as I am with Moshe. Well, I know that Yahushua, he was such a man of Yahuwah that he wasn't a prideful man. That it's wonderful that Yahuwah told him that, but he wasn't a prideful man to be filled with pride because of this. No, it would have humbled him even more to know that what Yahuwah was announcing to him would be something so incredible that all the people would know and understand and hold Yahushua as great. He says, I'll make you great because he was a courageous man, Joshua, but also because of how great this message is for us right now. Praise Yahuwah. Hebrews 8:8-9-10 says, for finding fault with them, he says, see, the days are coming, says Yahuwah, when I shall conclude with the house of Yisrael, the house of Yehuda, a renewed covenant, not according to the covenant that I make with their fathers in the day when I took them by the hand to lead them out of the land of Mitzrayim, because they did not continue in my covenant, and I disregarded them, says Yahuwah. Because this is the covenant that I shall make with the house of Yisrael after those days, says Yahuwah. Giving my laws into their mind, I shall write them on their hearts, and I shall be their Elohim Ya'am, and they shall be my people. Friends, this is after those days. It was after those days for Joshua and the people of Yahuwah at that time, as they were about to cross through the water, pass over. But also for you and I now, it is Passover time coming. Are you repenting in covenant, or are you disregarding? Are you understanding the full facet of everything in covenant, or are you disregarding? Write them on your hearts. Joshua 3:8, and you command the priests who bear the Ark of the Covenant, saying, when you come to the edge of the water of the Yarden, stand in the Yarden. And Yahushua said to the children of Yisrael, come near and hear the words of Yahuwah, your Elohim Ya'am. And Yahushua said, by this you shall know that the living Almighty One is in your midst, and that he is certainly driving out from before you the Canaanites, the Hittites, and the Hivites, and the Perizzites, and the Girgashites, and the Amorites, and the Jebusites. See, the Ark of the Covenant of the Master of all the earth is passing over before you into the Yarden. So we see the passing over again, being significant, being repeated over and over to Yahuwah's people. It's a prophetic happening then. It's prophetic for us now. Verse 12, and now take for yourselves 12 men from the tribes of Yisrael. 12 men. One man from every tribe. And it shall be as soon as the soles of the feet of the priests who bear the Ark of Yahuwah, the master of all the earth, come to rest into the waters of the Yarden, that the waters of the Yarden are cut off. The waters that come down from upstream and stand as a heap. And it came to be when the people set out from their tents to pass over the Yarden with the priests bearing the Ark of the Covenant before the people. And as those bearing the Ark came to the Yarden, and the feet of the priests bearing the Ark dipped into the edge of the water, now the Yarden overflows all its banks during all the time of harvest. That the waters which came down from upstream stood still and rose in a heap very far away at Adam, the city that is beside Sarthen, and the waters going down into the sea of Araba, the salt sea, were completely cut off, and the people passed over opposite Jericho. So we see here, brothers and sisters, and in verse 15, further evidence of the people of Yahuwah, and in representation of the 144,000 first fruit heirs, as it uses the word and the statement time of harvest. We see 12 people and then 12 tribes passing through, and then harvest, time of harvest being stated. Revelation 14:1-4 says, and I looked and saw a lamb standing on Mount Zion, and with him 144,000, having his name and his father's name written upon their foreheads. And I heard a voice out of the heaven, like the voice of many waters, like the voice of loud thunder. And I heard the sound of harpists playing their harps. They sang a renewed song before the throne and before the four living creatures and the elders. And no one was able to learn that song, except the 144,000 who were redeemed from the earth. They are those who were not defiled with women, for they are maidens. They are those following the Lamb wherever he leads them. They were redeemed from among men, being first fruits to Elohim and to the Lamb. So we truly see here this crossing through waters, untouched. The water significantly being pulled apart. Why? Just as it was significant for Moshe that the waters be pulled apart. As you pass through the waters on dry ground, it's important, the symbolization here, knowing especially that there is a firmament over this earth and there are waters all around the entire world that we know, which is why they hide that from you and they don't tell you the truth of it. And most, many, if not most, will not declare it or even preach it for fear. They're not courageous to teach that there's a firmament, that there's water outside the firmament, that the earth is a plane, a circle, a surface. They're afraid. They're cowards because of condemnation. But Yahuwah says to his people, don't be a coward. Announce the truth. Tell the people the truth. Don't worry about those who won't listen and don't care and who mock. But so many who claim to have their eyes open mock. Let them. We don't care. They won't be mocking during the time of the hour of our master. They'll be repenting. And praise Yahuwah, they will be given a chance to repent. But again, the passing through the Yarden, it says to that in verse 17 of chapter 3 of Joshua, the priests bearing the Ark of the Covenant stood firm on what? Dry ground in the midst of the Yarden. And all Yasaral passed over on dry ground until all the nation had completely passed over the Yarden. It makes the point twice here, brothers and sisters, to say dry ground. It's a supernatural underlying statement being made here for us and our future and the Harpazo. Luke 11, 23 and 24, significantly, it says, he who is not with me is against me. He who does not gather with me scatters. When the unclean spirit goes out of a man, he goes through dry places seeking rest and finding none. He says, I shall return to my house from which I came. Dry places is a dimension, a portal outside of this carbon-based matrix that we live in right now. And we have to have Master pass us through these dry places because it's so horrible that if you don't have him doing that, even these demonic unclean spirits in Luke 11, 23, and 24 go back into and invade men, possess them, because it's painful for them to be outside. Remember the demons that were cast out and they would even go into the pigs? Remember that? Because they couldn't bear to be in these dry places. But we will have the security and safety of the throne, the covenant ark of Yahuwah. When we pass through this interdimensional transition. Joshua now further in chapter 4 now, verse 1. And it came to be when the entire nation had completely passed over the Yarden that Yahuwah spoke to Joshua, saying, take for yourselves 12 men from the people, one man from every tribe, and command them, saying, take for yourselves 12 stones from here, and out of the midst of the Yarden, from the place where the priest's feet stood firm, and you shall bring them with you and leave them in the camp which you spend the night in. Now, 12 stones. We're going to be talking about two sets of 12 stones. This is the first set for a total of 24 stones. Now, stones declare things. And let's find out about stones before we understand further what these stones represent to us in the future and now. Luke 19:37 to 2:40, says, "And he was coming near already at the descent of the Mount of Olives. The entire crowd of the taught ones began to praise Elohe Am, rejoicing with a loud voice for all the miracles they had seen, saying, 'Blessed is the sovereign who is coming in the name of Yahuwah.'" Which name? Jesus? Yahshua? Yeshua? Yoshua? No. Coming in the name of Yahuwah. Peace in heaven and esteem in the highest. And some of the Pharisees from the crowd said to him, "Teacher, rebuke your taught ones." See, they wanted Master to rebuke. They were calling Master Yahuwah, that he was coming in the name of Yahuwah, saying he's coming in the name of Yahuwah. And they're like, "Rebuke them for saying that." But he answered, saying to them, "I say to you that if these shall be silent, the stones would cry out." Brothers, I know that I have not seen any other person announcing our Master as Yahuwah. And I long for that, but I see that people can't seem to do it. But we're declaring it, brothers and sisters. Why? Because he says in 19 verse 40 further, he says to them, "I say to you that if these shall be silent, the stones would cry out." We are crying out here at PraiseYahuwah.com. These stones are crying out. And what Master said in chapter 19, verse 40 was actually true. Because he didn't mean literal stones, although literally if Yahuwah wanted stones to cry out, they would. But stones represent people who would cry out that his name is Yahuwah. He is our Savior, to be respected in the name of Yahuwah. Because you cannot do the work that needs to be done unless you declare it in the name of Yahuwah the Father through the Son, Yahuwah. Casting out and doing all sorts of things in the name of the Son, which is the name of the Father. Two separate people, but two same names. Deuteronomy 27:8 says, "And you shall write all the words of this Torah on the stones, plainly and well." That's why we keep covenant. And we know that the name of Yahuwah is the first gate of salvation. And our Master said he is the doorway. So he is Yahuwah in his name. Not Yahuwah Almighty, but put at his right hand, at level with Yahuwah, by Father, who trusted him to be at that level, because he did just so, because he approved him, and because his name is Yahuwah, he came in the name of Yahuwah, he is Yahuwah now, and these stones will cry out this truth. Encourage. And brothers and sisters, stones declare things. Are you a stone of Yahuwah? Are you courageous in this? Or do you hold back? Do you sugarcoat? Do you use other names? Apologetically, almost. Now, stones are covenant keepers, because the Torah is written, the covenant is written on the stones. Job 5:23, "For your covenant is with the stones of the field." See, stones also represent things in Matthew 3:9. "Do not think to say to yourselves, 'We have Abraham as a father,' for I say to you that Elohe Am is able to raise up children to Abraham from these stones." Yes, brothers and sisters, to the Jewish line that refuse to accept our Master and are also following a different covenant, Yahuwah grafts in the Gentiles for a purpose, and he raises us up in representation of the covenant that we declare in his great name, in his Son's great name, our Savior. Now, stones even protect things. Isaiah 2:10-11, "Enter into the rock, hide in the dust, because of the fear of Yahuwah and the splendor of his excellency. The lofty looks of man shall be humbled. The pride of men shall be bowed down, and Yahuwah alone shall be exalted in that day." Does it say any other name? No, it says Yahuwah alone will be exalted. That's because Yahuwah is the name of the Father and the Son. So be protected by entering into the rock, as it says. Be a stone. Stand firm, be strong, Now stones build things. Revelation 21:19, the foundations of the wall of the city were adorned with all kinds of precious stones. Isaiah 54:12, and shall make your battlements of rubies, your gates of crystal, and your walls of precious stones. 1 Kings 18:31-32, and Eliyahu took 12 stones, another example of 12 stones, according to the number of the tribes of the son of Jacob, to whom the word of Yahuwah had come, saying, Yasarel is your name. And with the stones he built an altar in the name of Yahuwah. Yes, Yasarel, not Yisrael, or that ye are Ra, the false god, who is El, the false god. That's not right. Yasarel, almighty, loving Yahuwah. Sar, look at the, find out the meanings of Yah and Sar and Al, and know the truth in your studies. That's why we don't use the word El, because it's a false god, a false entity. Yahuwah is the only great one. His name is Yahuwah. The altar is in the name of Yahuwah. How are altars built? They're built with stones. Why? They're unhewn stones. They're unadulterated stones. They're not carved. Yahuwah gave specific instructions not to carve stones. See, his people are strictly in him, unaltered by the world, unleavened by the world, but as a sign, as a symbol. That's why there were 12 stones that Joshua told these 12 men to gather out from the Jordan that they walked through, this dry place, because they were going to be set up as a symbol, as a statement. Now, master is a chief cornerstone. We learn that from 1 Peter 2:4. It says, drawing near to him a living stone. See, a stone can be living and alive. That's why you're a stone. I'm a stone. It says, rejected indeed by men, but chosen by Elohim and precious. You also, as living stones, are being built up a spiritual house. See, this is now getting into Revelation with the 24 elders. A spiritual house set apart priesthood to offer up spiritual slaughter, offerings acceptable to Elohim through Yahuwah Moshiach. You are the very stones of the altar of the slaughter offering, spiritual. It says, because it is contained in the scripture, see, I say in Zion, a chief cornerstone, chosen precious, and he who believes on him shall by no means be put to shame. This preciousness then is for you who believe. But to those who are disobedient, the stone which the builders rejected has become the chief cornerstone. And a stone of stumbling, and a rock that makes for falling, who stumble because they are disobedient to the word, to which they also were appointed. Yes, the covenant word. They aren't covenant keepers. They stumble at this information we're giving today. They can't handle this information. They turn away from it. But you're a stone to cry out among those who will not listen. Romans 9:31-33, but Yasarel following after the Torah of righteousness has not arrived at the Torah of righteousness. Why? Because it was not of belief, but it was as by works of Torah. For they stumbled at the stone of stumbling. As it has been written, see, I lay as in Zion a stone of stumbling and a rock that makes for falling. And everyone who is believing on him shall not be put to shame. And all drank the same spiritual drink, for they drank of that spiritual rock that followed. The rock was Messiah. Who is Messiah? Yahuwah. We keep to the Torah of Yahuwah, not the works of the Torah of Moshe. And this is very significant, because most who believe in Yahuwah will not understand this point I have just made until it is too late and they find themselves in the midst of the hour of Jericho. And they will repent then. But we don't want you to repent then. We want you to overcome now. These stones are crying out to you now to listen. So that was 1 Corinthians 10:4, by the way, that said that the spiritual rock that they drink is a rock that is Messiah. Now you are a stone because 1 Peter 2:4-5, if you haven't figured it out yet, which I'm sure you have, drawing near to him, a living stone, rejected indeed by men, but chosen by Elohim and precious. You also as living stones are being built up. We'll say it again. You are that stone crying out. When nobody else will cry these things out, you will do it. Because you are a disciple of Yahuwah. Stones are disciples. That's why 12 stones were taken out of that. Matthew 16:18-19, I also say to you that you are Kepha. And on this rock I shall build my assembly, and the gates of the grave shall not overcome it. And I shall give you the keys of the reign of the heavens. And whatever you bind on earth shall be having been bound in the heavens, and whatever you loosen on earth shall be having been loosened in the heavens. So these 12 stones, representing the 12 apostles and the 12 tribes, 12 rocks are going to be in the reign of the heavens, doing things, binding things on earth, commanding things on earth. But there's 12 more stones, brothers and sisters. Yes, stones are you. Stones are also mounted when they're precious. Zechariah 9:14-16 says, Yahuwah shall appear for them, his arrow going forth like lightning, and the master Yahuwah sound the ram's horn, and he shall go with the whirlwinds from the south. Yahuwah of hosts shall shield them, and they shall devour and trample on sling stones. They shall drink, roar as if with wine. They shall be filled like basins, like the corners of the altar. And Yahuwah their Elohim shall save them in that day as the flock of his people. For the stones of a diadem sparkling over his land. A diadem, brothers and sisters, is a jeweled crown. A headband worn is a symbol of sovereignty. You are the very jewels in the crown of our king. Sparkling for the world to see. Mounted because you're precious. Verse 14 of Revelation chapter 14, and I looked and saw a white cloud. We know that represents the cloud of 144,000. And sitting on the cloud was one like the son of Adam, having his head a golden crown, and in his hand a sharp sickle. Now Yahuwah is a rock, and we all know this. We're familiar with that. It says, trust in Yahuwah forever, for in Yahuwah is a rock of ages. Come, let us sing to Yahuwah. Let us raise a shout to the rock of our deliverance. That's Psalms 95:1. Psalms 18:2. Yahuwah is my rock and my stronghold and my deliverer. My Almighty is my rock. I take refuge in him, my shield and the horn of my deliverance and my high tower. What does it say is the name of the rock? Yahuwah. Who is our master? He's the rock. His name is Yahuwah. These stones will cry out. Now, stones are also for destruction. In many scriptures in Bible, stones were used for the purpose of justice. You are a stone, and you will be used for the purpose of justice upon this earth in the hour of Jericho, brothers and sisters. At the great war that culminates at the end of it. Remember the different stonings that occurred over and over in scripture that was talked about. Stoning witches. Remember Mary? She was a harlot whore, so they were going to stone her. And he said, he who's without sin, cast the first stone. Representing justice many times, good or bad, right, righteous or wrong, it represents the idea of justice. Stoning of several people of Yahuwah all throughout history, the prophets, apostles, disciples, several places, Old and New Testament, stoning people. And especially were people stoned when they were sinful and going against Yahuwah. That happened. Stones have been hidden, by the way, and then revealed. Jeremiah 43:9-11 says, take large stones in your hand, and you shall hide them from before the eyes of the men of Yehuda in the clay and in the brick courtyard, which is the entrance of Pharaoh's house in Tapenhez. Then you shall say to them, thus is Yahuwah of hosts, Elohim of Yisrael, see I am sending, and I shall bring Nebuchadnezzar, the sovereign of Babel, my servant, and I shall set his throne above these stones that I have hidden, and he shall spread his canopy over them. See, brothers and sisters, you were chosen from before the earth was ever formed. You were made to be a stone of Yahuwah, an unhewn stone, an untwisted stone, an untainted stone, a stone washed white. But you've been hidden all these years, and you're going to be revealed as well. And Master sits upon these stones, is represented. It says, and he shall come and smite the land of Mitzrayim, bringing death to those appointed for death, captivity to those for captivity, and the sword for those of the sword. Who wields the sword? Yahuwah. Who does he sit upon? The stones. Exodus 39:14, in showing 12 stones, represents Yasserel. It says the stones were according to the names of the sons of Yasserel, 12 according to their names, engraved like a signet, each one with its own name, according to the 12 tribes. So these first 12 stones represent the literal stones of the people of Yahuwah, Yasserel. Now, stones are gathered, taken, and they represent freedom and security and redemption, literally rapture or harpazo. Isaiah 62:10, 11, and 12. Pass through the gates. See, this is an expression from the prophet Isaiah, Yashiyahu, about Passover or passing through. And he's declaring it again himself. Prepare the way for the people. Build up the highway. Remove the stones. See, harpazo, take the stones out, lift up a banner for the peoples. See, Yahuwah has proclaimed to the end of the earth. Say to the daughter of Zion, see, your deliverance has come, his reward is with him, and his work before him. See, we have work to do under him. It says, and they shall be called the set apart people, the redeemed of Yahuwah. And you shall be called sought out, a city not forsaken. See, brothers and sisters, you are stones to be removed and taken out and passing through. Psalms 27:5, for in the day of evil he hides me in his booth. In the covering of his tent he hides me. On a rock he raises me up. So yes, we are his. We are overcoming. We are cleaning ourselves right now. We are washing our robes. See, stones polish up. Especially a river stone. Have you ever seen a river stone? Have you ever taken river stones out? Have you seen how smooth they are? How round they are? How soft they almost feel, even though they're hard? And if you leave them out in the sun a few days, they develop this bleached white look from the sun and from the light, like white garments. And they just look very desirable. Luke 3:5, 6, 7, and 8. Every valley shall be filled, and every mountain and hill shall be made low, and the crooked shall become straight, and the rough smooth ways. And all flesh shall see the deliverance of Elohim. He said therefore to the crowds that came out to be immersed by him, brood of adders, who warned you to flee from the wrath to come? Therefore bear fruit worthy of repentance, and do not begin to say to yourselves, we have Abraham as father, for I say to you that Elohim is able to raise up children to Abraham from these stones. Smooth ways, it says in verse 5. And that's what you are, a polished stone, immersed, stones in water, fully immersed, repentant, not just relying on our bloodline. No, we rely on repentance. Bearing fruits worthy of repentance. How many fruits are there that this declares? Well, if you look in most Bibles that have been twisted, it shows 12. I mean 9. But brothers and sisters, even of those 9, 3 of them are synonyms. So there are really only 6 declared in 99% of all Bibles. But we know from Wycliffe translation 1390, it says that there are 12 fruits there, not 9. And they're all unique, not repetitive. So there's 12 full fruits declared that we're able to find this little nugget of information that no other Bibles have. This is how you know Bibles have been twisted. And also because in evidence of Revelation 22, 1 and 2, it says there are 12 fruits, one for every month. So there are 12 fruits. And then when we bear fruit worthy of repentance, like we just read in Luke 3, 8, we become smooth and polished stones of Yahuwah, 12 being very important. And yet there are still 12 more stones to be gathered. Joshua 4:4, and Yehoshua called the 12 men whom he appointed from the children of Yisrael, one from every tribe. And Yehoshua said to them, pass over before the ark of Yahuwah, your Eloah, Ya'am, in the midst of the Yarden. And each one of you take up a stone on his shoulder. Now he's giving them a directive. Take the stone on their shoulders. According to the number of the tribes of the children of Yisrael, pure and straightforward representation here, brothers and sisters. Further, it says, so that this shall be a sign in your midst. A sign. When your children ask in time to come, what do these stones mean to you? Well, this is that time to come, brothers and sisters, right now, today, 11-11 of 18. You shall answer them that the waters of the Yarden were cut off before the Ark of the Covenant of Yahuwah. When it passed over the Yarden, the waters of the Yarden were cut off, and these stones shall be for a remembrance to the children of Yisrael forever. And they are a remembrance that these are stones passing through and being harpazoed out. Exodus 28:12, you shall put the two stones on the shoulder pieces of the shoulder garments as stones of remembrance for the sons of Yisrael, and Aaron shall bear their names before Yahuwah on his two shoulders for remembrance. So when Joshua told them to take the stones and to put them on their shoulders, it meant something. Because in Exodus 28:12, Aaron had stones put on the shoulders as for remembrance also, but also that their names would be seen by Yahuwah, before Yahuwah. It says in Exodus 39:7, and he put them on the shoulders of the shoulder garment, stones of remembrance for the sons of Yisrael, as Yahuwah had commanded Moshe. Joshua 4:8 now, it says, the children of Yisrael did so as Yahushua commanded, and took up the 12 stones from the midst of the Yarden, as Yahuwah had spoken to Yahushua, according to the number of the tribes of the children of Yisrael, and took them over with them to their camp, and laid them down there. Yahushua also set up 12 stones in the midst of the Yarden, in the place where the feet of the priests who bore the Ark of the Covenant stood, and they are there to this day. So there were 12 more stones that Yahushua took up, also for remembrance. And in the same way, everything was done. So very subtly here, though it doesn't say 24 stones, there is a total of 24 stones, which represents the passing through, and it represents the 24 elders. The 144,000 in heaven, passing through dry places as a symbol, as a sign, there to this day, it says, because it's forever. Now, stones literally that Yahushua put down wouldn't literally stay there forever, because stones can be removed, literal stones. This was a symbolic meaning. Because in Revelation, it talks about these two sets of 12 stones. I praise Yahuwah because he helped us to realize there's 24 stones. And I'm sure people and others that have sought to teach have looked for 24 stones, and they never found, or they found, or signs of 24 elders, and they never found them because they're looking for 24. But it's broken up into two sets of 12. 24 stones to fully as a symbol. Verse 10 of chapter 4, the priests who bore the ark stood in the midst of the yard until every matter was finished that Yahweh had commanded Yahushua, to speak to the people according to that which Moshe had commanded Yahushua. And the people hastened and passed over. So the symbology of the 12 plus 12 stones, which equal 24, and the gathering out from the wilderness into this inherited land in a Passover through dry places, with water all around, but not on them, in safety, and the declaration. Yes, 24 stones. Now remember, significance of 6 earlier. We spoke about that. The 6th book of Scripture. The number of man is 6, just short of 7, which is the perfection of Yahuwah. Now 6 twice witnessed is what? 12. See, man is a witness. 12 disciples, 12 stones. Just like there were 12 spies, 12 witnesses, 2 spies, 2 witnesses, 6 witnessed twice, being 12. 12 is a number of declaration in Scripture, brothers and sisters. It means I declare. The number of the disciples and the number of light of declaration, spiritual daylight. It's also the number of the fruits of the Ruach, which are 12, which are declared, which nobody declares, but the stones will declare. We here at PraiseYahuwah.com will declare 12 fruits and where we found them, truly found them, in the Wycliffe translation from 1390. Where everybody else will continue to teach 6 only. We witness, and so therefore it is 12. And that's why 6 twice witnessed is 12. 6 fruits in regular Bibles, but 6 more fruits there are. You say, well, there's 9 fruits in Bibles. No, 3 of them are synonyms. There are 6 fruits in all Bibles except Wycliffe. And we found the 12 in Wycliffe. 6 twice witnessed is 12, 12 fruits. We've been declaring it since the beginning when nobody else will. We praise Yahuwah. Remember, there's 12 months in a year. A year is 1. A year, 1 can be 1,000. But now if you take 6 and it becomes 12, what happens when you take 12 and it becomes 24? 12 times 2 is 24. 12 witnessed twice becomes 24. Just like 6 witnessed twice becomes 12, 12 witnessed twice becomes 24. As in the 24 elders. And today we declare that the 24 elders truly are witnessed again in Scripture by way of Joshua. And it is a great day to be alive, brothers and sisters. Revelation 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5. It says, after this, I saw a door having been opened in the heaven. The first voice which I heard was like a trumpet speaking to me, saying, come up here, and I shall show you what has to take place after this. And immediately I came to be in the Ruach, and I saw a throne set in heaven, and one sat at the throne. And he who sat there was like a jasper and ruby stone in appearance. And there was a rainbow around the throne. Around the throne was a rainbow. We're going to talk about something that happened that was a rainbow that was round that occurred at the time of our master's death as a sign. But here it says there was a rainbow around the throne like an emerald in appearance. And around the throne were 24 thrones. And on the thrones I saw 24 elders sitting dressed in white robes. And they had crowns of gold on their heads. And out of the throne came lightning, thunders, voices, and 7 lamps of fire were burning before the throne, who are the 7 spirits of Eloi Ya'am. Yes, this is the Ruach, spirit of Yahuwah. There are 7 of them. They all have unique functions. They are his breath. So 24 is made up of chosen mankind, brothers and sisters. 6 being the number of mankind, right? The number of sinful man, not quite 7. But guess what happens now when you take 6 times 24, which we've already determined and know without a doubt the 24 elders are of mankind. 6 times 24 becomes 144. 1 to 1 or 1 to 1,000 in Yahuwah. So 6 times 24 is either 144 or it's also 144,000 as a sign. If you take 144, by the way, and you add 9 to it, add up 144. 1 plus 4 plus 4 is 9. So take 144 and add that 9 back to it, and you get 153. 153 is the redeemed stones. John 21:11 says, Shimon Kepha went up. Remember, he's the stone, Kepha. Shimon Kepha went up and dragged the net to the land. And with 153 big fish, and though there were so many, the net was not broken. Yes, 144 plus 9
is 153 fish. There's 153 fish being gathered. Those 153 fish represent out of the sea of mankind. They represent the 144,000 brothers and sisters. Do you see? All these words, all these books declare a gathering, a harpazo, and a rapture. And nobody's... There are those that say there is no rapture when it's all throughout Scripture. Not only that, but there's two raptures. There's the rapture of those which are the 12 tribes, which are being brought out through the Jordan, the Yarden. And then there's the rapture of the harlot who repents, who's in Jericho at the time of distress, who is going to be taken out. We're going to read that the rest of this quickly here. It says in another reference to the 12 and 12 is in Revelation 21, 12. It says, and it's very interesting, it's how it's verse 12 of chapter 21, which is 2, 1, 1, 2. It's like 12 backwards and 12 forwards, pointing to this scripture. And having a great and high wall, having 12 gates, and at the gates 12 messengers, and names written on them, which are those of the 12 tribes of the children of Yisrael. And verse 14 says, and the wall of the city had 12 foundations, and on them were the names of the 12 emissaries of the Lamb. And verse 21 of chapter 21, which is 12-12 in reverse, 2-1-2-1, or 1-2-1-2, and then 12 gates were 12 pearls. Each one of the gates was a single pearl. And the street of the city was clean gold like transparent glass. Now further, getting back to Joshua 4:11, it says, it came to be when all the people had completely passed over that the ark of Yahuwah and the priest passed over in the presence of the people. And the sons of Reuben and the sons of Gad and half the tribe of Manasseh passed over in fives before the children of Yisrael, as Moshe had spoken to them. Now, I told you we were going to talk about what that fives represented, and it's crucial. It's significant. They passed over and through on dry land these stones in the first taking out before the second rapture of the harlot woman. The number five means this. In Scripture, it's significant because it means creation. Five. Man has five fingers. Man has five senses. Man has five toes. There's lots of things that are symbolic of five. Thus it is with the number of Yahuwah's Kanan, or some would say is his grace. This was a display and declaration by the tribes in solidarity together in groups of five. Spiritual organization of Yahuwah's people walking in groups of five through this harpazo in his Canaan. It was a parade that says we are his and we walk not in our way, but in his way. And so they did just so. This is a statement of spirituality by this parade. Now we know that there are five great statements in Scripture. There's the Father, there's the Son, there's the Ruach, there's the creation, and finally, mankind's redemption. Fives. John 6:11-13 says, and Yahuwah took the loaves, having given thanks, he distributed them to the taught ones, and the taught ones to those sitting down. And the same with the fish, as much as they wished. And when they were filled, he said to his taught ones, gather the broken pieces that are left over, that none get wasted. So they gathered them. And they filled 12 baskets with broken pieces of the 5 barley loaves, which were left over by those who had eaten. 5 brothers and sisters becomes 12, because 12 becomes 144,000, because 12 becomes 24, which becomes 144,000, which becomes 153 fish, which are pulled out from the sea. Brothers and sisters, we see the word gathered used twice here in John 6:13, because this is a reference to harpazo, to taking out. It's a reference to the bread of life, our master, the perfect loaf, these 5 barley loaves, the representation of the Father, the Son, the Ruach, the creation and redemption. becoming 12 baskets full of broken pieces, which we have been broken in this world, have we not? And these broken pieces are gathered twice to 12. 1 Corinthians 11:24, and having given thanks, he broke it and said, take, eat, this is my body, which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me. Yes, he is the bread of life, the barley loaves, which become broken, which are gathered. Romans 11:19, you shall say then, the branches were broken off that I might be grafted in. Yes, brothers and sisters, you're grafted in. Joshua now, 4:13, getting back. About 40,000 armed ones of the army passed over before Yahuwah for battle to the desert plains of Jericho. It's interesting, brothers, because I was doing some calculations. And do you know what percent 40,000 of 144,000 is? See, if these ones passing through are the 144,000 figurative, the percentage of 40,000 of 144,000 is 27.777777. That is the percent of the warriors, the armed warriors of Yasserel. Will this also be the number of the 144,000 that Yahuwah will use as select warriors in the great battle to come, the battle to end all Jericho? I think so. Further now and quickly, Joshua 4:14. On that day, Yahuwah made Yehoshua great before the eyes of all of Yasserel. And they feared him, and they feared Moshe all the days of his life. And Yahuwah spoke to Yahushua, saying, command the priests who bear the ark of the witness, and let them come up from the Jordan. And Yahushua commanded the priests, saying, come up from the Jordan. Where have we heard that before, brothers and sisters? Several times in Scripture. Come up here, that phrase. Come up here. It represents that you're coming through and up through this body of water, this dry place, through this Jordan. Come up, it says in verse 17. And now verse 18, and it came to be when the priests who bore the ark of the covenant of Yahuwah had come from the midst of the Jordan, the soles of the priests touched the dry land, that the waters of the Jordan returned to their place and flowed all over its banks as before. And the people came up from the Jordan on the 10th day of the first month, and they camped in Gilgal on the east border of Jericho. And those 12 stones which they took out of the Jordan, Yehoshua set up in Gilgal. And he said to the children of Yasserel, saying, when your children ask their fathers in time to come, saying, what are these stones? Then you shall let your children know, saying, Yasserel passed over this Jordan on dry land. For Yahuwah, your Elohim Ya'am, dried up the waters of the Jordan before you until you had passed over, as Yahuwah, your Elohim Ya'am, did to the Sea of Reeds, which he dried up before us until we passed over. So that all the peoples of the earth shall know the hand of Yahuwah, that it is strong. So that you shall fear Yahuwah, your Elohim Ya'am, forever. Wow. Praise Yahuwah. There's so much here. We've gone over 2 hours, but we're going to keep going. We're going to do chapter 5 and chapter 6 because this is climactic and it's crucial. And I don't think there's ever been a more important message. Joshua 5, first one, it came to be when all the sovereigns of the Amorites were beyond the Jordan westward, and all the sovereigns of the Canaanites who were by the sea heard that Yahuwah had dried up the waters of the Jordan from before the children of Yasserel until we had passed over, that their heart melted. There was no spirit in them any longer because of the children of Yasserel. Brothers and sisters, this is when you are taken and the world sees that there is this rapturing, this harpazo of the first fruits, and they're left behind. Their hearts will melt, and subsequently we'll see the two witnesses and their hearts will melt even further for those who refuse to repent. It says in verse 2, at that time, Yahuwah said to Yehoshua, make knives for flint for yourselves and circumcise the sons of Yasserel again the second time. So Yehoshua made knives of flint for himself and circumcised the sons of Yasserel at the hill of foreskins. And this is why Yehoshua circumcised them. All the people who came out of Mitzrayim, who were males, all the men of battle, had died in the wilderness on the way after they had come out of Mitzrayim. For all the people who came out had been circumcised, but all the people who were born in the wilderness on the way as they came out of Mitzrayim had not been circumcised. Brothers, this represents two groups. It represents the old group, and it represents the uncircumcised. Many people don't realize that these were uncircumcised Gentiles in representation here, because they weren't circumcised. They were as though they were Gentiles. And yet they were able to pass through. They were able to be harpazoed and raptured out because they were grafted into Yahuwah, these broken pieces of bread that were gathered. And they were only circumcised after they passed through. Isn't that amazing? And a lot of people don't know that. A lot of Jews today don't know that. That's why circumcision, physical, actual circumcision, doesn't matter. It's circumcision of the heart. Physical circumcision didn't even matter for them to pass through safely into the new land. They had to be circumcised there because it represented a spiritual circumcision for today. Isn't that wonderful? It says in verse 6, the children of Yisrael walked 40 years in the wilderness till all the nation, the men of battle who came out of Mitzrayim, were consumed because they did not obey the voice of Yahuwah, to whom Yahuwah swore not to show them the land which Yahuwah had sworn to their fathers that he would give us, a land flowing with milk and honey. See, these people were covenant keepers of Yahuwah's covenant, not covenant keepers of the covenant of Moshe. If they were covenant keepers of the covenant of Moshe, they would have also been circumcised already when they were born. But they were born and they were kept uncircumcised. That's important for people to understand. It's a witness to many things that we won't get into today, but that we've spoken about many times here. Verse 7, Yehoshua circumcised their sons, whom he raised up in their place, for they were uncircumcised because they had been circumcised on the way. You see, that's a representation of walking in the way, spiritual circumcision. And it came to be when they had completed circumcising all the nation that they stayed in their places in the camp till they were healed. And Yahuwah said to Yahushua, today I have rolled away the reproach of Mitzrayim from you. So the name of the place is called Gilgal to this day. And the children of Yisrael camped in Gilgal and performed the Passover on the 14th day of the month at evening on the desert plains of Jericho. 14th day, day of Passover. In representation of the Passover they just physically did. And they ate the stored grain of the land of the morrow after the Passover, unleavened bread and roasted grain on this same day. And the manna ceased on the day after they had eaten the stored grain of the land. And the children of Yisrael no longer had manna, but they ate the food of the land of Canaan that year. And it came to be when Yahushua was by Jericho, that he lifted up his eyes and looked and saw a man standing opposite him with his sword drawn in his hand. Who wields the sword, brothers and sisters? Our master, Yahuwah. So this is Yahuwah. And Yahushua went to him and said to him, are you for us or for our adversaries? And he said, no, for I have now come as captain of the host of Yahuwah. And Yahushua fell on his face to the earth and did obeisance and said to him, what is my master saying to his servants? He called him master. And it says, the captain of the host of Yahuwah said to Yahushua, take your sandal off your foot, for the place where you stand is set apart. And Yahushua did so. Why is this important? Because this is what Moshe was told to do at the burning bush, brothers and sisters. You see, master has represented Yahuwah for a long time. And in scripture, where many people think it was Yahuwah the Father, was actually Yahuwah the Son. Yahuwah is our master. But Yahuwah has been using his son for a long time. Here he refers to himself as the captain of the host. So again, what does master do when we go up to the heavens? When we harpazo and we're around the throne? And it talks about the one who comes? And how he's wielding a sword? It's the same in representation here. They had already passed through. They had already been raptured. Just like in Revelation 4 and 5, the 24 elders were around the throne and Master wasn't there yet. The Father was there, but not the Son. Because it said that nobody was there to open the scrolls, remember? Master wasn't there. We know Master is the one who opens the scrolls. So we're there. Well, we see here that the stones are now in Jericho. They've already passed through Jericho. They already passed through the Jordan. just as we will pass through and be around the throne. Then Master comes here with a sword. Yes, in Joshua 5, but also in Revelation 4, Master comes. And so it's a statement that this represents the same thing, and that it represents the 24 elders. Now, as a side note, there's no more physical manna, because spiritual manna comes from who? Our Master, who wields the sword. Revelation 2:16-17, repent or else I shall come to you speedily and fight against them with the sword of my mouth. He who has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says to the assemblies. To him who overcomes, I shall give some of the hidden manna to eat, and I shall give him a white stone, and on the stone a renewed name, which no one except him who receives it knows. Brothers and sisters, I say today that this is spiritual manna revealed from Joseph, and you are a stone, I am a stone, and we will shout and we will declare this hidden manna, which has been given with a renewed name, the name of Yahuwah. Now we're in the final chapter, chapter 6. It says, and Jericho was shut up tight because of the presence of the son of Yasarel not going out and none coming in. And Yahuwah said to Yahushua, see, I have given Jericho and its sovereign mighty brave men into your hands. And you shall go around the city, all the men of battle going around the city once. Do this for 6 days. Brothers and sisters, in the year 2031, 6,000 years will be up. It says, do this for 6 days. Yes, Father, we will do it for 6 days. See, the tribulation of Jericho doesn't happen in this 6 days. The tribulation of Jericho happens on the 7th day. But in the 6 days, you're going to go round and round. The time of man to Savior's death, 4,000 years, the time of Savior's death to us now, 2,000 more years, or for a total of 6 days. Ecclesiastes 7:1, a good name is better than precious oil, and the day of death than the day of one's birth. Yes, we measure the 2,000 years from the day of Master's death. Now, how can we know the day of Master's death? Did you know Emperor Guangwu of China, where they keep excellent records, has a recorded writing on the 4th month of AD 31. That's the year 31. You know what he declared? That would be June of 31 all the way till June of 2031. It would be 2,000 years. And here's why we think it's that time. Because it says, here's what the emperor said. Back in 31, he declares a great eclipse, unlike any other, wherein there was an extended darkness like the sun and the moon switching places, and that sins of all the people are now on one man. Pardon is proclaimed under all of heaven. This is an emperor talking about an eclipse that occurred in 31 AD in the 4th month, talking about redemption and pardoning and proclamation and sins being removed and a great eclipse. Remember, there was an eclipse for 4 hours, from the 6th hour to the 9th hour, or from noon to 3 o'clock that day. And this was worldwide, it said. It stopped. That's why they knew it in China. I tell you, the Chinese were Christian long before all these other pagan religions. These Chinese believed in our Master when their emperor is proclaiming our Master. Also, at this exact same time was another recorded proclamation from Gihan Annals, number 18. It was a writing, and it wrote of a great eclipse on the day of Guihai. Man from heaven died, quote unquote. Luke 23:44 says, and it was now about the 6th hour, and darkness came over all the land until the 9th hour. 6 being key here, brothers and sisters, again, the number 6. Number 9, also, when you add up 144,000, 6 represents man, 9 represents, plus 144 represents 153, the redeemed of mankind. That's why it's from the 6th to the 9th hour there was an eclipse. Do you understand what Yahuwah is revealing to us? 3 days after this event that this emperor and also Gihai Annals number 18 documented this happening. 3 days after the Chinese recorded something else. Remember we talks in Revelation about the rainbow circling the throne? 3 days later, upon our master being raised, it's documented that a rainbow encircled the sun, a declaration of the resurrection of our master. So remember earlier where we talked about the rope, talking about pain. And remember, Revelation talks about the birth pains from the woman. Then it talked about through the midst of that, there's a repentance. That's what Master preached. And then, of course, his subsequent resurrection, which is the harpazo. And so these three things were declared in China at this time, declaring all three things. And we see it represented here in the book of Joseph, or Joshua rather. And we see it happening at the time of our master, and it's amazing. And now you know why the sixth hour to the ninth hour is relevant and what it meant, that it had a meaning. Those numbers had a meaning. And it's truly a declaration of mankind going and being redeemed into the perfection of the 144,000. Joshua 6:4 says, let seven priests bear seven ram's horns before the ark, and on the seventh day go around the city seven times while the priest blows the horns. Now, brothers and sisters, the 6 days have ended at the seventh day, right? The 6,000 years end, and the 7,000 years is about to begin. We read in Hosea that at the end of that 6,000 years and in the morning, that that's when all of this would begin. And so we're ready for it. And so they were ready for it because they blew the horns six times and then the seventh time. Now it says in Revelation 4:5, and out of the throne came lightnings and thunder and voices. Seven lamps of fire were burning before the throne, which are the seven spirits of Elohim. That's why the seven spirits are around the throne with the 24 elders, brothers and sisters, and with Master. And seven used so many times. And the trumpet blasts. Verse 5 now says, it shall be when they make a long blast with the ram's horn, and when you hear the sound of the horn, that all the people shout with a great shout, and the wall of the city shall fall down, and the people shall go up, every man straight before him. It says, and it shall be. Hasn't happened yet. Remember, the whore is still in the great tribulation. She's still in the midst of Jericho. But paralleling verse 5 here is Revelation 8:6, which it says, the seven messengers who held the seven trumpets prepare themselves to sound. Now, verse 6 of chapter 6, and Yehoshua, son of Nun, called the priests and said to them, take up the Ark of the Covenant. Let seven priests bear seven ram's horns before the Ark of the Covenant. And he said to the people, pass over, go around the city. Let him who is armed pass over before the Ark of Yahuwah. Now, I believe this is significant, brothers and sisters, because when we come back with Master, we'll be passing over again, but this time in a reverse Passover, a reverse harpazo, a reverse rapture. In that, we will be here with Master getting ready. Those 40,000 warriors also will be ready to fight. It says in verse 8, now it came to be when Yahushua had spoken to the people that the seven priests bearing the seven ram's horns before Yahuwah passed over and blew the horns, and the Ark of the Covenant of Yahuwah went after them. And the armed men went before the priests and who blew the horns, and the rear guard came after the Ark going on and blowing the horns. Again, clearly representing our master and his warriors and the announcers and the announcement. And the whole world will shudder. Verse 10, but Yahusha commanded the people, saying, do not shout or cause your voice to be heard, nor let any word come out of your mouth until the day I say to you, shout, then you shout. And the Ark of Yahuwah went around the city, going around once, and they came into the camp and stayed in the camp. And Yehoshua rose early in the morning, and the priests took up the ark of Yahuwah. The seven priests bearing the seven ram's horns before the ark of Yahuwah were walking, going on. And they blew the horns, and the armed men went before them, but the rear guard came after the ark of Yahuwah, going on and blowing the horns. And the second day they... Now, friends, this is significant. This is talking about... this is talking about revelation. This is actual happening of great tribulation and what is happening, what Yahuwah is doing, what we will be doing with him. This is actually talking about the periods of time. And the second day, this is why the Antichrist will be around for 7 years, by the way, 7 days. Because it talks about first day, second day, third day, fourth day, fifth day, sixth day, and what happens on the seventh day. So now we're at the second day. It says in verse 14, on the second day, they went around the city once and returned to the camp. Thus they did 6 days. And it came to be on the seventh day that they rose early about the dawning of the day and went around the city 7 times in this way. Only on that day, they went around the city 7 times. And it came to be at the 7th time when the priests blew the horns that Yahushua said to the people, shout, for Yahuwah has given you the city. What does this remind you of? It reminds you of 1 Thessalonians 4, 15, 16, 17, and 18. Because what does it say? For this we say to you by the word of Master, that we, the living who are left over at the coming of Master, shall in no way go before those who are asleep. Because the Master himself shall come down from heaven with a shout, with the voice of a chief messenger, and with a trumpet of Eloiam. And the dead in Meoshiach shall rise first. Then we who are the living, who are left over, shall be caught away together with them in the clouds to meet the Master in the air, and so we shall always be with Master. So then encourage one another with these words. When this happens, when we are, the very rapture of Yahuwah's people will become a shout to the world. And that's why they will be in great fear when they see that these things are happening. If Denyandi are fortunate enough, when that happens, that'll be the day you will hear no more broadcasts here. Because when there's no more declaration of the word, then you know that I am dead and I am taken, because I will not be here, because I'm going to declare the word of Yahuwah all the days of my life until my death. And I will do so publicly. Joshua 6:17, and the city shall be put under the ban and all its belongings to Yahuwah. Only Rahab the whore is to live, she and all who are with her in the house, because she hid the messengers that we sent. So brothers and sisters, it's the midst of this 7 days. The 7 days haven't happened yet, because at the seventh time, on the seventh day that they blow 7 times, on that particular day, everything is destroyed. So they have to get her out in the midst of this tribulation period of 7 years, or the 7 times that they go around, the 7 days before it collapses. But she's not taken out first. She's taken out second. It was Yahweh's people as a sign who are raptured up at the beginning through the Yarden. And that's the first rapture of the 144,000 and the 24 stones around the throne. But now this is with Rahab, who is now redeemed, who has repented. She's repented from her whoreness, her whoredom, her immorality. Sadly, she has to go through this. She has to be courageous. So for all those that might hear this word after the rapture, take heart and stand firm and know that nothing can hurt your soul, because Yahuwah has you. Man can hurt your body, but they cannot hurt your soul. And in the twinkling of an eye, you'll be with Master. So if you're hearing this in the tribulation, take heart in this. Yes, you were left, but repent. Turn to him. Hear the words that Yahuwah has helped us to reveal and to state to the world. Keep covenant. Keep it in love. Keep it the right way. Understand the importance of this covenant. You will be circumcised. It's okay that you're not now. You don't need to be walking in a covenant of someone else or another group or in other ways and means, but in the covenant of Yahuwah. And so they saved Rahab the whore and all her belongings. It says further in verse 18, and you, by all means, guard yourself from that which is under the ban, lest you come under the ban when you take that which is under the ban and make the camp of Yahsarel a curse and shall trouble it. So don't be any part of the world. Repent. Stay out of it. Verse 19, all the silver, gold, vessels of bronze, iron set apart to Yahuwah, they go to the treasury of Yahuwah. See, don't be like the one disciple who stole from the treasury and didn't make it. Don't be seduced by gold of man and then lose your crown. That's what's being told here. Because this isn't to the harlot that he's talking to. This is his 144,000. Verse 20, but all the people shouted when the priest blew the horns. And it came to be when the people heard the sound of the horn, the people shouted with a great horn, that the wall fell down flat. The people went up into the city, every man straight before him, and they captured the city. And they put under the ban all that was in the city, both man and woman, young and old, oxen, sheep, and donkey, with the edge of the sword. And to the two men, these are the two witnesses, who had spied out the land, Yahushua said, go into the house of the woman, the whore, and from there bring out the woman and all that she has, as you swore to her. That's the actual second rapture, brothers and sisters, praise Yahuwah, in Joshua. And the young men and the spies went in and brought out Rahab and her father and her mother and her brothers and all that she had. So they brought out all her relatives and set them outside the camp of Yahsarel. Brothers and sisters, many of you are going to be raptured and taken. You're going to leave behind family. You're going to leave behind family. But they're going to hear these words for the first time. And they're going to know what they must do to repent and to be like Rahab, so that they can at least make it through the tribulation. Our dear children, our dear brothers, our dear sisters, our mothers, our fathers, will at least have the opportunity to repent, though they won't listen now, and turn back. Verse 24, and they burned the city and all that was in it with fire. Only the silver and gold and vessels of bronze and of iron they put into the treasury of the house of Yahuwah. However, Yahushua kept alive Rahab the whore, her father's household, all that she had. She dwelt in the midst of Yahsarel to this day because she hid the messengers whom Yahushua sent to spy out in Jericho. So yes, the two witnesses are going to come. And those people who repent are going to be part of the two witnesses in one fashion or another. Verse 25 declares it here. And it guarantees that these ones in the tribulation will be in the midst of Yahsarel, that they'll be part of us. They'll be in our group, our gathering. They'll be with us. They'll be taken out. They won't be the first fruits, but they'll be the second group in gathering. Be strong, children. Be strong, sisters, brothers, fathers, and mothers. Be strong and be courageous in this time. Verse 26, Yahushua warned them at that time, saying, cursed is the man before Yahuwah who rises up and builds this city, Jericho. He lays its foundation with his firstborn, and with his youngest he sets up its gates. This is referring to the cursed horn, the Antichrist, and all those who are part of the Antichrist system, the children of the Antichrist, from the oldest to the youngest. Cursed are them, because of what is going to come upon them. They will have no hope in this figurative Jericho great tribulation that is coming. And finally, lastly, in verse 27, Yahuwah was with Yahushua, and a report about him was in all the land. So brothers and sisters, 1 Corinthians 15:52, mistakenly by many, is thought to be the last trumpet blowing. But know this, it says, in a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trump, not trumpet. Many Bibles say trumpet, it's not trumpet. Some Bibles say trump, and it's significant, because if it was the last trumpet, then it would already be too late for a rapture. We are raptured already because we're going to be the ones blowing the trumpet. How could we not be raptured yet? We're going to be part of the, involved in the trumpeting. But it says in a moment, in the blinking of an eye, at the last trump. Now you look at Strong's for that word trump, and it says basically it's a vibration, a billow, a wave. You see, it's something that's more subtle. You'll be raptured at a more subtle time, a more subtle tribulation. That is from G4535 in Strong's. And it's from G4525, which says seno is the word in Greek. It means to wag, like a dog wagging its tail. What does a tail do when it wags and it goes back and forth? It's a sign, right, of your animal. When you look at an animal's tail, a cat's or a dog's, when a cat's tail stands straight up, my wife has proven to me that that means our cat's extremely happy. It's a sign. When a dog wags its tail, it's very happy. That tail is a sign. The last trump is a sign. It's a subtle vibration, but it's not a full-blown trumpeting, because it says further in 1552 about trumpeting. It says, for the trumpet shall sound. Now we're talking about the trumpeting. The trumpet shall sound, and the dead shall be raised incorruptibly, and we shall be changed. So the first trumpeting that occurs, but not a final trumpeting or a last trumpeting. This is a last trump. Not last trumpeting as in the seven trumpets being blown. It's different. Trumpeting is from the word salpinx, which means to trumpet, to sound, to blow, to announce. It's very interesting that right now, and I'm not endorsing Donald Trump, but Don means leader. Leader Trump, a last name called Trump. I don't think it's any mistake that in this period of this 7 years, he was voted in as president 2016, began in 2017 to 2018 to 2019 to 2020, where I believe there'll be a re-election and he'll be re-elected, and he'll be from 2020 to 2024. That 2024 will be the end of the 7 years of the sign of Jonah for this country. And I believe this country will crash and the Antichrist will come in. And for 7 years, the Antichrist comes in leading to 2031. And 2031 is the end of the 6 days, as it must end. Because in the seventh day is 1,000-year reign. It's a time of peace. It's a time of resting after all these matters. And so it's important to know these years and these numbers and understand the prophets and understand that there's a statement of two raptures. Understand that there's 24 elders that represents 144,000 of the 153 fish. That 12 is meaningful. That 12 twice is meaningful. 6 twice is meaningful. Because you are the stones of the 24 stones that are gathered. And finally, in Ecclesiastes 3, verse 1. For every matter there is an appointed time, even a time for every pursuit under the heavens, a time to be born and a time to die, a time to plant and a time to uproot, a time to slay and a time to heal, a time to break down, a time to build up, a time to weep and a time to laugh, a time to mourn and a time to dance, a time to throw away stones and a time to gather stones. To gather stones in the almighty loving name that is Yahuwah.
This concludes this seventh day audio broadcast of It's Time for Truth. I'm your servant host, Denya Cajaliero, and you need to know that your comments, suggestions, and support are very, very important to us here. Please send your contact email directly to praiseyahuwah@yahoo.com, or go to our contact webpage by clicking on the phone icon at the homepage at www.praiseyahuwah.com. This is the day that Yahuwah has made, so rejoice and be glad in it. Until next week, be a blessing to all and be blessed.